Welcome to today's webinar, how to solve your Selenium problems without getting rid of Selenium. Now, before we jump into the topic itself, let's talk a little bit about the challenges or the reasons why Selenium is important and why organizations are taking a stronger focus on making sure that they're delivering reliable customer experiences. When we look at the industry, and especially within B2C markets, we see disruption is everywhere. Competitive landscapes are changing. New players are entering the markets. One of the obvious examples is the disruption that Uber has brought to the taxi industry. But this is also happening within financial markets as well. So industries where initiatives such as open banking or PSD2 in Europe are driving the breakup of the financial industry to introduce competition. So the landscape is changing. Also, there is a constant demand for innovation and new technologies. And this is how the disruptors are capturing the market. Innovators are leading their industries by delivering new technologies, new capabilities to their clients in a rapid and reliable way, leveraging the concepts of Agile and DevOps. But delivering that innovation is only one part of the solution. If you're not delivering that innovation in a reliable way, delivering a reliable customer experience, your customers are going to switch. Switching costs have never been lower. I'll give you my personal experience. I was opening up a new online savings account, transferring some funds from an existing bank that I had to a new bank, because that new bank was offering promotions and incentives for me to transition. I actually looked at two different banks, and one of them, the process was seamless. I could transfer my money during the online process. The other was not. The other failed at the last moment with a, sorry, we ran into a problem. And quite frankly, that bank will no longer have any of my business because they've lost. They tried to provide me the innovation, they provide me the promotion, but it fell short at the very end of the process. So how do we make sure that we are able to deliver a reliable customer experience? Well, we do that through testing. Testing to make sure it works, but make sure that it works continuously. So, you test to make sure it works the first time, but it has to work as part of an ongoing delivery process. Change is happening all the time in the application. New functionality is being introduced. You want to make sure that your existing functionality is not broken. The way that you enable that is through automation and by providing an infrastructure that can help you streamline the delivery of your application to market. But the thing that's coming down your infrastructure is not something that's slow and predictable and you can see coming from a long way. It's actually a bullet train. It's something that's coming really quick, really fast, delivering innovation to your customers. And if you don't have an infrastructure which can handle the velocity of your delivery, then you're going to come off the rails and your competition is going to go right past you. So really the key here is to put a test automation infrastructure in place that where you can validate the repetitive tasks, freeing up your manual testing activities to focus on the human intuitive or customer user experience, intuitive workflows, so you can streamline your delivery. So how do you build a test automation strategy that's scalable? The testing pyramid is something that Parasoft has been behind for a number of years now. It was first introduced by Martin Fowler and Michael Cohen, who are some of the pioneers of the Agile community. And really what we're saying here is that this pyramid is how you organize your testing strategy. You want to have a lot of unit tests and service level or API level tests that provide you a foundation to build your application on top of. These tests are easier to execute, they're easier to diagnose, they can be run very quickly as part of your CI/CD pipeline. And then you want to minimize the number of end-to-end UI-centric testing practices. Doesn't mean to say you're eliminating them. You are minimizing them. They're still critical because ultimately that is where the customer interacts with your application. But from the point of view of putting an infrastructure in place, those pieces are really the much harder ones to automate and the ones that organizations struggle with. And we're going to talk about those struggles in a moment. I would actually argue also that there's a missing layer of the testing pyramid, and that's the ground that the pyramid is built upon. This is where you need to make sure that the code that's being developed by the team is both reliable and secure. And you do that through deep code analysis, going beyond what you would get with an open source technology, such as SonarQube, for example. Now, at Parasoft, we've been doing testing continuous quality for over 30 years. So we have the opportunity to talk to many different organizations, and almost everybody that we talk to is at some layer or at some stage of their adoption of test automation. But most people will identify that they struggle with the ice cream cone, where they have a lot of manual or very labor intensive, long execution time, UI centric testing practices, and much less at the lower levels, in some cases with no unit testing being done by development teams in some cases. Now, as I said, we do talk to a lot of clients about their current testing challenges and strategies. And as we talk through them, really we uncover that it's really not an ice cream cone. It's much more like a martini glass, where many organizations spend a lot of time creating and maintaining their UI-centric tests. And then that doesn't leave a lot of time to move further down the pyramid. And that's kind of an upside down approach. You would expect that really should be going bottom up, but because the UI is intuitive, it's easy to understand. That's what normally your requirements are written around. That's why many organizations kind of try to melt the ice cream cone. Now we have technologies at each of these layers are of the testing pyramid, and we'll touch upon those at the end of today's session. But today what we're focusing on is the UI automation. And before we talk about that, obviously, we're talking about Selenium today, but Parasoft is a very data-driven company. So when we looked at the challenges of UI testing, one of the first questions we asked was, what are you using for UI testing today? And this was to help us understand what we should build from a product, from a technology perspective. Now, we knew Selenium was out there, and a lot of people were using it, but what we didn't realize quite was how many people had standardized on Selenium. Because there are other open source frameworks out there. There's Cypress, for example. There's a lot of commercial tools in the market space. And as you can see here from our survey, we identified there was a little over 64% of the people that we surveyed were actually leveraging Selenium. And this survey is from webinars like this. It's also from interactions at trade shows, as well as customer interviews as well. It's a little over 600 respondents. We actually recently ran this again at a recent trade show, Star West in California. And at that trade show, we got over 70% of Selenium. And we also ran this during one of our customer workshops as well, and got actually around about the 70% number as well. So we see Selenium growing in adoption within the market. Also coming out of those surveys and that data, that's helps us understand what the UI testing challenges are that the industry is facing. And you can see here that maintainability is right at the top. You can see time taken to execute the tests, element locators, UI changes, browsers. And then you actually see that initial script creation is kind of down there towards the bottom of the list. Now, you might remember when you signed up for this webinar, there was actually a question asking what your number one testing challenge was. And the results from that survey actually mirrored very nicely the historic data that we captured previously. So from our audience today, 61% of the audience had identified that their number one challenge was related to maintenance. Digging into that maintenance a little bit further, we can actually see that changes to the UI represent the largest problem, with wait conditions and locators falling in below that. Stepping back again, creation is kind of in that second category. And then the execution time that it takes to run those tests is kind of the third area. And we're going to dig into each of these three today, focusing on how we can help with those three challenges. Now, when we look at those challenges and we talk about the problems, these kind of break down into these six different areas. As I said, maintenance being the number one, and there are three types of maintenance problems that folks typically face. Weight conditions, dynamic web applications today, the elements are not always available, timing issues come into play due to performance on the back end, due to performance on the front end, and those weight conditions can be really hampering the stability of the test cases. Maintenance due to locators. Many applications have dynamic IDs or dynamic class variables. These things make it very difficult to build a reliable test based upon locators within the page. Debugging, diagnosing, automation failures, and then time taken to execution. As I said, we're going to touch upon each of these, and this is where I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Chris. And Chris is going to show us some of those testing challenges.
Thanks, Mark. So yeah, today I'm going to go through a demonstration where we're going to touch on each one of these areas, show how we can overcome some of these challenges. So to do that, I'm going to assume the role of a test automation engineer. I'm going to be working on UI testing, specifically with Selenium. I am in Eclipse, and I've built some tests using Java JUnit 4. In this particular example. I'm particularly proud of these tests, A, because I'm somewhat new to Selenium, and so I spent a fair amount of time building these tests, and they cover some very critical use cases, accounts, bill pay, request loan, in my application that I'll show you in a little bit. But the reason I'm really proud of these is I'm using a best practice known as the page object model, which we're gonna dig into a little bit later in the demonstration. I get frustrated though when the application goes through rapid change because quite often my test cases break and I spend a large portion of my day going through and maintaining those test cases. And so today, in fact, development announced that some new changes were introduced into the application and I now need to go and run these tests to see are there any regressions in the application. But secretly, I want to make sure that my tests still work against that application. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and do a sanity check here and run the existing version of my test against the existing version of the application. And I'm just using a run configuration here, and I've defined a variable here where I'm pointing at the currently hosted version of the application, version 1. And I'll go ahead and run this. And like I said, I'm simply doing a sanity check here to make sure that my existing versions of my Selenium tests work against the existing version or the current version of the application. Okay, first test was good, accounts. Now we're gonna jump here into bill pay. Okay, it looks like that one was successful. And now the last one, which is request loan, which represents some connections with some third-party systems that we have. Okay. All three of my tests were successful. This doesn't surprise me. They have been running during my continuous quality process quite successfully. Now, version 2 of the application is available. And what I want to do is just run the existing version of my test against the new version of the application. And to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm simply going to change that endpoint to now point at version 2 of the application. I'm also going to activate Parasoft Selenic. Now, Selenic takes many forms, most commonly as the command line argument that you would add to your existing Selenium execution. But here I'm using the run configuration inside of my IDE. It has many options. We'll discuss these in a little bit. But in general, what Selenic helps you do is if your tests fail, it helps identify why they failed and helps you to recover from that failure. Spoiler alert, these tests are about to fail. So now I'm going to run my tests against version 2. It looks like the first test was successful. So maybe there weren't huge changes to the application. All right, here comes the second test. Okay, maybe I spoke too soon. So it looks like I'm stuck here, trying to enter some information into phone number, potentially zip code, not entirely sure. Okay, well, it looked like that one failed. Here comes my third test. Remember, this one's against the request loan function. And my, it looks like the UI in this one has changed significantly. It looks like maybe there's some dynamic loading content happening. Okay. Well, unfortunately, two of my test cases failed, and I would have to go now and try to debug that. But the good news is that Parasoft Selenic was watching. So what we're looking at here is an analyzer report from Parasoft Selenic. Selenic monitored the execution, and when it detected a failure, it took a look at what was happening in the application during that failure and is now providing you with details, information, and potential recommendations. So here I can see that of my three tests, one test passed, two of them failed, and it has some understanding or some suggestions for me about why those tests potentially failed. So the first one here, Parabank Bill Pay, it says it was the Bill Pay test that failed. It was waiting for an element to be clickable. We provide a screenshot so that you can, if this ran during your, say you had this integrated as a part of your continuous build process, potentially in Jenkins, you could then go and look at the report. Okay, this is where this broke down. And then the second one says that a click was intercepted. Ooh, that sounds aggressive. Parabank request loan. I can look at a screenshot and see where that took place. Now, this is good because I'm getting details about where my test is breaking down and why my test is breaking down. But the really good news here is that this one in particular has a recommendation. So let's go ahead and look at this. Here's where you can see Parasoft Selenic's AI at work. What happened is that this test could not click on payee phone number. The application changed, something moved. And because I could not click on payee phone number, we threw some stack trace and some failure in the test. However, Parasoft Selenic is now providing me with a recommendation on how I can fix my test so that it doesn't break here. And it does this by going through the executions of the application over time, taking a look at the different states, the document object model, comparing those, and then determining the best locator that will not only work on the current version of the application, but would work on previous versions of the application. And we construct the very best locators possible so that the test becomes more resilient to change going forward. We also provide test details and a stack trace so that you can feel comfortable in applying these back into your test scripts. So let's go ahead and apply this to my test script. Now the great news is the recommendations are automatically delivered back into the test creator's IDE. They're delivered as recommendations, and it makes it easy for us to view those locators and jump directly to the line of code that needs to be updated. In this case, here, payee phone number. I can then take a look at the locators, and this is the same information. And you'll notice before that I had a confidence factor. That confidence factor is derived from a couple of different factors, stability, or would this locator have been successful over multiple versions of the application, and weight, which is a customizable factor that allows me to prioritize different strategies such as IDs, names, XPaths, CSS locators over others in case my application does better with those different types of locators. Well, in this case, this is the locator that I want to use. So I'll go ahead and click update, and the change is made right in my code. I could then immediately rerun this test and see that the test will no longer fail due to the element locator. And so we'll see that happen right here. So here comes the second test, bill pay. And you'll see that it's now successful. Now I still have this third test, but we'll talk about this in just a second. Now, this is great. Selenic is now helping me with the maintenance of my test cases. It's making the recovery from changes in the application a much quicker process because I can immediately jump back into my application and leverage those recommendations right here in the IDE. But wouldn't it be cool if Selenic automatically self-healed my tests at runtime? See, in order for that to happen, I had to get a test that failed. And if that had happened during my nightly CI execution, sure, I would have gotten a new AI-generated locator, but I would miss that execution. I wouldn't get the results from that. So Selenic has the ability to automatically self-heal these tests at runtime. So I'm going to go ahead and show this by reverting my change. I've now broken this test again. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to run Selenic with self-healing. So self-healing says, hey, go ahead and try that out. So instead of having the test fail and then generating the locator, try swapping it out at runtime. You notice this is not only for locators, but also wait conditions. Selenic can automatically predict when a test is going to fail due to a wait condition, try out different wait condition strategies, and try to self-heal those wait conditions at runtime. Let's give this a go. So we know that our first test was successful. So we'll just roll right through that one. But now in the second one, this is going to happen quickly. When I get to the affected locator, the test is going to stall. Look in the bottom right-hand corner. You'll see self-healing is initiated. It finds a locator, and the test proceeds. Now, what about that? This dynamic content? Well, it turns out this is different wait conditions. Waiting for element to be visible, waiting for element to be interactable. Right here in the bottom corner, you can see self-healing initiated again, and all three of my tests are now successful. I didn't lose any time during my execution because I was using self-healing. Now here's an analyzer report. This looks slightly different. This indicates to me that I had one test that passed and two tests that were healed. A healed test is not considered passed. You still have a test to fix. Although those tests were healed, one due to a wait condition and one due to a locator. And again, if I was to drill down into these, I could see the same information, except it gives me a little bit more information here. We were going to fail because of this, but we tried this and we used that to heal the locator. And for those wait conditions, if I come back into my report, the reason that we couldn't click on the apply now button was because it was obscured because it was waiting for that element to load away. By waiting an additional 2 seconds, the button became unobscured and we were able to click the button and proceed forward. And we have a recommendation here to wrap the test in a fancy wait condition here, in this case, a fluent wait. And this is great because through this, I can add to my existing Selenium test execution, the ability to generate locators, AI-generated locators, as well as get self-healing of both locators and wait conditions without having to affect any of my code. But wouldn't it be cool if we were able to build great Selenium tests like this from the very beginning? Well, that's where the third part of the story comes in, and that's one of creation. See, I had to hand crank this Selenium test, and that's okay. But I want to have the ability to build Selenium tests like this, even if I don't have super familiarity with Selenium code. So to do that, I can employ Parasoft's Recorder. I'm just going to clean up my browser here real quick and open my application. Go to So what actually happened in the application, if we dig in a little bit and we go to this bill pay page, not only did a new element show up, but this phone number became dynamic, which means every time that this application restarts or I land on this page, this locator is going to change. And so we were able to build a locator that is now resilient to the dynamic nature of the ID by keying into some other pieces. But now what I want to do is I want a test that actually covers this email piece. So I'm going to go ahead and log out, get my application to the state that I want, and I'll go ahead and turn on the Parasoft Recorder. Now, Parasoft Recorder has long existed for extracting API tests from manual interactions on the UI, which helps us to build API test scenarios using AI to look for patterns and relationships. It's now been extended to allow us to do the same for UI actions. Like I could do this simultaneously if I wanted to grab my API traffic and my UI traffic, but for here, I'm just going to go ahead and start a UI recording. Go ahead and log into the application. I'll go here to the bill pay section, enter in some information, adding an email, an account, send the payment. There we go. Now I'll log out. I'll then jump back to my recorder and say, stop recording. Parasoft Selenic will then let me know that I have an artifact for creating the test. I'm going to go ahead and call this Parabank Bill Pay and give it a description. This is testing the new bill pay flow. I can associate a requirement so that I can link that back to one of my stories in Jira for traceability and download the recording. So this is my artifact that I'm going to use to create my test with. Go ahead and save that. Now I can either use it myself to create a test or hand it off to another test automation creator. I'm going to use it myself. So you'll see that when we create the test here, it's going to use the page object model. The page object model, again, is an industry best practice that lets us define our pages as objects. And then you can define your element locators on those pages. This not only associates the elements to the pages to which they are found, but also makes the test a heck of a lot more maintainable. Because if you want to use one of these locators, you simply reference it in accordance to the page that it's associated with, and then you only have to maintain that in one spot. Make a change on the page, and it propagates through the rest of the test. Now, because I've recorded a new test for this same flow, I could actually bring that test artifact right here and update my page objects, thus adding new pages or new actions to my existing Selenium test. And that's great, because it makes that that maintainable. But I want to build a brand new Selenium test project from scratch. And Parasoft Selenic makes that easy by providing a quick wizard that allows me to define a project name. And we'll just call this Parabank 2. Pointed at my artifact. This is the one that I just recorded. I'll give it a package, com, Parabank, and then a class. We'll call this bank tests, and then we will finish. So you'll see here that I have a brand new project that's been created. I have a Selenium test that we're looking at right here. The project has all the necessary libraries and dependencies required to execute, and it's using the page object model, which means this is going to be much more maintainable going forward. I can now immediately execute this test by using one of the built-in run configuration options here with Parasoft Selenic. And this not only allows me to immediately build and leverage Selenium tests, but also makes the process of taking advantage of recommendations and locators and self-healing, as well as building API tests on the fly, incredibly easy. All right, well, I'm gonna go ahead and hand it back to you, Mark, to talk us through what we just saw.
Great, thanks, Chris. Okay, so what Chris showed us, let's kind of start with the end. He showed us the Parasoft Recorder directly integrated within Chrome. As Chris showed us there, it's actually been available for a little while. Parasoft introduced the Recorder for Chrome for API tests last year for our SOI test product. And what that'll do is that'll actually capture my interactions that I can then use to create my page object model. Those Selenium scripts are what I call pure Selenium. They have no vendor lock within them. So you can then take them and execute them as part of your regular CI/CD process. They're creating them using the page object model that, as Chris mentioned, is the industry best practice. And as you do more recordings, you can start to update the page object model as well. So it's not just a case of creating a new project each time you do a recording, but also being able to take and expand out the model. Now, we believe that this is a great way to get going with Selenium and get started, get over the initial hurdle of trying to understand what a UI is doing, and also getting over the initial hurdle of getting familiar with Selenium. Selenium is a code level a UI test automation, but it's really, you're writing Java code, but you're not writing a full end-to-end application. You're just writing a script that's controlling the UI framework. So this really helps get you over that initial hurdle. It's directly within the IDE. Chris showed us Eclipse today. IntelliJ is coming. It's going to be available in our Q1 release around about the February timeframe. And then those tests, as I said, can be executed as part of your CI/CD process. What Chris showed us was running those tests inside of the IDE, but it's really a one-line code change to the command line to execute those tests as part of the Jenkins workflow. We'll actually show you what that command line looks like in a moment when we talk about something else in a second. Now, as I said, those tests can be run completely independently of Parasoft, but if you're going to run them with Selenic, we can then inject the self-healing with a one-line code change to the execution script, and actually it's just attaching to the Java agent. And then that self-healing provides recommendations back to the dev tester, the person creating scripts. Those recommendations are available both in HTML, so that HTML report that Chris showed you can be output directly from your Jenkins process. That data can also be imported into the IDE. So again, we showed you the workflow from the IDE today, but imagine that you've got a Jenkins process running in the background. The data that comes out of the analysis is available and can be imported directly into the IDE, where you can do the quick fixes. All around how we can reduce the maintenance burden associated with the tests. So if you remember what we talked about earlier, we talked about the maintenance, the report that we generate out of Jenkins or out of the IDE workflow helps you diagnose and debug what's going on. That's one of the challenges that people face when they're running Selenium tests as part of their Jenkins workflow. They don't get enough information, enough data to understand what the actual test failure is. The report is available for that purpose. And then we also talked about the kind of reducing the knowledge and skills required, or reducing the burden of knowledge required to get going with the scripts. But we did miss one of the things. We missed one of the challenges, which is that of the time that it takes to execute the tests. As you move further up the testing pyramid, your tests take longer to run. And that's because of the amount of infrastructure that's in play, but also the complexity of the workflows. Obviously, unit tests are much more discrete. They're smaller, they're isolated. That's the purpose of them. They run quickly. As you move up the pyramid, you're going to start leveraging back-end systems, front-end systems, third-party systems potentially. So the time it's taken to execute those just takes longer. And while we're showing you in the demo today, three tests, you know you don't have three tests. You don't have 300. You probably have 3,000 or more tests that need to be created. How can I optimize that execution so I'm not having to wait, several hours for results of a regression, or wait overnight, or even in some cases over a weekend, so that I can get immediate feedback when the development team make a small change in the application? I'm able to get feedback as quickly as possible before they move on to the next thing in the development process. This is where the concept of test impact analysis or change-based testing comes in. Here we can optimize the execution by focusing on the changes in the application. So through the use of Parasoft's proprietary coverage analysis, we're able to understand what parts of the code base were executed by individual tests. We can then analyze the application, analyze the Java binary in the case of a UI test, or analyzing the actual build process if we're talking about unit tests, and understand what has changed within the code base, and then rationalize the test suite so you're only executing the subset of tests that validate the changes to the application. Now, we actually have this technology available for each of the layers of the automated testing pyramid. We introduced it with our JTest product for JUnit test cases last year, both in the IDE, because that's where the developer is making the code changes, is right there in the IDE, but also as part of the CI process. The purpose of that is, as I said, to provide rapid feedback based upon the changes that they've just made, so you can get confidence in moving forward onto the next story in the backlog. Moving up the pyramid, we have actually just introduced this for our Parasoft SOA test product, which is designed for doing API testing. And we're also introducing this with Parasoft Selenic for Selenium-based UI tests as well. So with that being said, let's go ahead and show how that works. And then let's also show how we could integrate through the command line.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so as Mark said, you know, reality is we're not talking a small number of tests. We're talking, you know, thousands of tests. And so typically what you would do is you would execute those tests as a part of your continuous execution. Here, what I have is basically, here what I have is your standard Maven, in this case, execution, but it really it's just a command line execution of my Selenium test that I would execute from my build system or as part of my nightly automation. What you do is you can make a one line change to your execution to bring in Parasoft Selenix. So in this case, this is where I am going to be executing it, collecting coverage from the application, and then later you'll see when I execute it, I can add different arguments for self-healing, recommendations, things like that. So that's what I do every night. I just, or as a part of every check-in, I just run all of my tests and I collect the coverage and I associate them to the application. Then, when required, during my check-ins, I can run just the affected tests. So what this does is by understanding which code we've touched, which tests, and then analyzing the new WAR file, no reason to touch the code, we just touched the binary, we can then delta the difference and execute just the test. And so here's basically the execution. Here you can see, you know, self-healing, capture screenshots, so on. So I think this is easier if I demonstrate this. So essentially what I'm gonna do here is simulate a check-in. Boom, code's been checked into source control for the new Parabank application. Build process kicks off and says, let's go ahead and run the affected tests. Sorry about that. Run the affected tests. So a couple of things are going to happen. The first thing it's going to do is it's going to, because it's Maven, it's going to pull in any required dependencies to make sure that everything's up to date. And then once it gets to the end of this piece here, it's going to grab that coverage file. You can see it doing it right here. It's reading the coverage file and saying, okay, what tests cover which code? Now it's going to scan the new version of the WAR file here, the updated Parabank, version 2. Looking in all the affected classes, it's then going to say, okay, based on that, what tests do I need to run? And so here it's made its decision. There's a little output up here that says it's going to run the build pay test, but we can see I ran 3 tests, but the real change in the code took place in just build pay. Build pay would normally fail, but I've got self-healing turned on. So in terms of execution time, in order to validate the code change that was made, I only needed to rerun that one test case. And that test case didn't fail because I was using self-healing. A little bit of double punch there. All right, back to you, Mark.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Chris. And we're, thank you very much for everybody that's been asking questions as we've been going. I've been answering some of those directly. Others I'm reserving for the Q&A session. But please go ahead and keep adding those in, though. And we'll kind of triage more as we go. So let's kind of talk about the 4 key capabilities of Selenic. And one of the things I want to emphasize here is that this is no change to your existing Selenium testing practice. So if you're already doing Selenium, that's exactly the right target for this product. It's designed to help you with your existing practice. If you're trying to get started, then obviously the creation is going to help you get going there as well. So let's talk about the four key capabilities. The first thing is the AI-powered recommendations. This is the first thing that Chris showed us. This gives us the ability to reduce the time spent maintaining, fixing, or updating your tests. The UI changes, Selenic is going to advise you and recommend how you could update the test, and it's going to provide you those directly in the IDE where you can apply the quick fixes. But you don't want your tests to actually break the CI/CD pipeline. What you want to do is to try and move forward. If Selenium or Selenic can help you recommend on Selenium, really, can we use that to help fix the processes or repair the tests as it goes? And that's where self-healing comes in. The point of self-healing is to not, it's to reduce the number of failing builds due to unstable or broken tests. What we are not doing here is we are not changing the code at runtime. We are just changing how Selenium is interacting with the application. That interaction helps us validate which recommendations are going to work in the tests. And then we give that back to you, the developer or tester, to update your Selenium tests. No, remember when Chris showed you the report, it said you still have tests to fix. We don't want to be changing the code automatically, because really you want to have a human in the loop, if you like. It's not all AI just kind of running rampant. What you want to do is you want to say, yes, this is the right thing. Take that information and update the test. The tests need to be maintained and managed as a source artifact. Now, as I said earlier, getting going with Selenium is sometimes challenging for organizations. The Parasoft Recorder for Chrome will actually capture those UI interactions and translate those into page object tests. Now, we do have organizations and clients where they already have an existing testing practice. And typically we find that organizations start to build their own framework on top of Selenium. What this can help you with is kind of capturing the current user interactions and then using that to copy and paste into your framework. And once you've got over that initial hurdle and that initial bump. And then the last thing, as your testing practice grows and matures, you're gonna have thousands and thousands of tests. You want to get rapid feedback. That's the whole point of a CI/CD pipeline and the DevOps workflows, is to get rapid feedback on the quality of the application that's being delivered. Test impact analysis helps you optimize your test execution so you can get that feedback quicker. Now, this fits into a whole portfolio, a quality suite from Parasoft. And really, as I said earlier, we have technologies that fit at each layer of the pyramid. So our JTest product, as well as its sister products, C++ test and dot test for C and C++ and .NET development. JTest has deep code analysis focused on reliability and security, going beyond open source, as I mentioned earlier. It then has technology which assists in the process of creating JUnit test cases. And these are done the same way that the Parasoft Recorder does for Selenium, in that these don't have any vendor lock within them. So you're creating truly portable JUnit test cases. And then we also have additional capabilities such as code coverage and test impact analysis available as part of CI/CD workflows. Moving up the pyramid, we get to API testing and SOA tests. We've had two or three folks ask about how do I create API tests from the UI. I think we're going to want to talk about that a little bit more. Chris, I'm letting you know you might need to do a demonstration if we have time. API tests, we believe very strongly, are the sweet spot on the testing pyramid. This gives a great communication channel between a test and a dev role. It's much more isolated than a complete end-to-end UI workflow. It runs quicker, it's easier to scale, and it's actually easier to generate load to do load and performance testing against your application. Now, when you start doing load and performance testing earlier in the process, or if you're doing it in a shift left mode, you're gonna start running into infrastructure constraints, databases that are not available, mainframes that are not available, external third parties where you don't have the same bandwidth through that external test system that you really need to be able to test your application. And this is where the concept of service virtualization comes in. Service virtualization allows me to simulate my backend dependencies and do that in a way that I have full control over my test environment. And then Selenic sits at the top. This is what helps reduce the maintainability and stability issues associated with Selenium-based UI tests. And really what we hope you've seen today is really streamlines that process for organizations. So if you'd like to learn more, there is actually a free trial available on the website. So if you go to parasoft.com/Selenic, you'll see a big blue button that says get a free trial. If you don't want a free trial, you just want a demo, you want to talk to somebody, please email info@parasoft.com. And then there's a whole bunch of other great resources on the website, such as our blog and also our YouTube channel as well. Okay, so we've got a whole bunch of new questions that have come in, which is great. Thank you very much. I'm going to start looking through those. Chris, why don't you do this? We've got three people that were asking about API testing. Okay, are you set up to be able to do an API testing demo?
Yeah, just one second.
Okay, so while you're setting that up,
what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to drop the links here into the chat real quick, just in case anybody wants to work with a free trial, and that will give my thing a chance to come up. Let me just drop this over here.
Okay, I'm going to just, while you're setting that up, I'm going to read off random questions. So one of the questions is around the free trial. Does it have any limitations, or does it have full capabilities? It has full capabilities. When you look at the trial page, there are two options. One is a cloud-based desktop, and one is an on-premise installation. The on-premise installation has access to absolutely everything. The cloud-based desktop does have some limitations associated with the Amazon infrastructure that it's plugged into. But if you want to have access to absolutely everything, including recording on your own website, go and select the, I think we call it PowerSoft guided workflow. So go ahead and go down that path, and then you'll have access to everything. Okay, what are the limitations on the types of healing that can be performed by Selenic? Selenic is focused on locators and weight conditions. There really aren't any limitations per se. The way that the AI engine works is that it's analyzing the history of the web pages, which it makes it very resilient to changes within the UI. We're taking into consideration not just individual attributes, but the structure of the element, where it sits in the page. And then we have an advanced pattern matching algorithm that tries to, in essence, relocate it over time, as Chris was showing you. Okay, we've got a couple of questions about Jenkins that I'll tick off really quickly. I think they're kind of plugging together. So Jenkins integration, as you saw, it's just a jar file that you plug into your script, and then you reference it through the Java agent. The HTML report, and actually there's a JSON file, a JSON data file that's generated as well. They can be stored within your Jenkins infrastructure and then imported into the IDE or emailed out in the case of the HTML report. And then another question on Jenkins here was running on remote machines. So if you're running, this kind of, when I think about remote machines in the Jenkins world, there's kind of two workflows. One of those would be Selenium Grid, where I'm kind of doing my execution on browsers that are on other machines. So Selenium Grid, frankly, just works because of how we're interacting with the Java agent. There's nothing you really need to set up there. When it comes to executing on Jenkins slaves or clients, in that scenario, what you're going to do is you're going to tell the remote execution to store its history in a shared drive, and then that's how that works. Okay, so I think Chris is ready. The questions we're being asked is like, how can I capture the API tests that are being, or the APIs that are being executed as part of the UI? And we have a couple of different workflows here. One is by actually recording them as I'm interacting with the front-end UI through manual tests. That's actually what the recorder would do. And then the other is actually by integrating part of Selenic can actually talk to the SOA test to tell it about the API traffic that it sees and use that data to create the API tests.
And that's actually the one that I want to show. So I did show that whenever we're recording a scenario, we can easily just connect right to SOA test, capture the API traffic as we're building the test. But if I have an existing Selenium test, one of the hidden options, and there are many, inside of Selenic, and by hidden, I mean right out here in the open, is the ability to create API tests. So basically what that does is makes a connection to SOA test, our API testing solution. And when the Selenium test executes, we'll go ahead and take out those API tests and then create API traffic and create the API tests. So what I'm gonna do is I'm actually just gonna run that as a part of my self-healing run. And what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna put that to one side and put good old SOA test, your SOA test, over on the other side. So now what we'll see as these tests are executing is this guy is now starting to build. So we we can capture the traffic for each of the scenarios that are executing. But we take it a step further because we can look for patterns and relationships in that traffic and make connections between the data so that you can have an API test scenario that's exchanging the dynamic data, doing some basic assertions, building those basic assertions, some of the self-healing finish here, and then we get our test. Now, not only are our API tests great from an execution perspective, because if I just get rid of Selenic here, if I go ahead and run that, boom, three API tests performing exactly the same actions as I did in my UI running in 1 second. That's a significant advantage. But in order to make that much more approachable, the built-in AI here, let me go ahead and expand this, has done some things for me, such as building smart associations between different elements, automatically data banking and parameterizing, building some basic assertions to see if data is changing. So in this particular case, it saw that the balance was changing. And then I can immediately run these API tests side by side with my UI tests so that I can understand if one piece of those breaks, is it in the client side? Is it in the API? Is it in the actual browser? And it just cuts the problem down. And it's as simple as just executing those existing Selenium tests. All right, let's launch this again.
Great, thanks, Chris. So hopefully that answered the questions on the API testing. If you have follow-on questions, please feel free to go ahead and throw those in. If we can get to them today, great. If not, we'll follow up offline as well. So a couple of questions around different types of framework and languages. So I'll kind of bulk these all together. So today, Selenic supports Java-based Selenium scripts. We are focused on, well, today we support JUnit 4. We will be adding TestNG and Cucumber support in the release that's due out the middle of December. Team are currently working on that. And then moving into next year, we'll be adding support for JUnit 5, not just for execution, but also for creation. So the recommendations and self-healing, we're gonna be focused on those for Cucumber and TestNG. And then JUnit 5 will be both creation as well as the recommendations and self-healing. Now, we had a couple of questions about other languages other than Java. As I mentioned, we are a very data-driven company, and we're also very agile in our roadmap. So you'll actually see that the roadmap is actually available and on the public forum. Chris, you can go ahead and show how we can get access to that directly from the product.
Sure, I'm actually going to show that directly from the product. So right here inside of Selenic, anytime you want to, you can just pop right up, give us some feedback, or take a look at the community. We have a supportive community here, and front and center here is our roadmap. We do really encourage you to weigh in on that. When organizations are taking advantage of this, and it's helping us really to define the direction that we're going with this. So pop on here, take a look at what we're doing, give us some feedback.
Yeah. And now what I'll say is that regarding the other languages, so as I said, we're focused on Java right now. JavaScript and Python has come up a lot, enough that we'll be looking at that next. Now, when we survey at trade shows and doing webinars and what have you, we tend to find that Java itself is much larger. Many more people. My English is failing me, but basically, it is the majority of people are using Java. Then it's JavaScript and Python are about the same. But when you add them together, there's still nowhere near the number of people that are using Java. And then C# is less than either JavaScript or Python. Now, that being said, we are looking at those languages. You won't see them on the roadmap yet because we're still at the very early stages of that right now. Hopefully that asked the question. I got a couple of folks on this session asking about C#. We normally get one or two people asking about that. And then normally kind of a few more asking about kind of the JavaScript and Python. So we are listening, we've heard it. I think that's kind of something which you'll see an update to the roadmap coming as we move forward towards the end of this year. There is another question around integrating with IE. So it's a little difficult. I did answer this one through the chat channel, but it's a little difficult to explain it in just a chat. So let me kind of restate it. So Selenic works with any browser playback. So you can playback in IE, Edge, Safari, Chrome, Firefox, in essence, anything that has a Selenium web driver. So the self-healing and the recommendations work across all of those browsers. When it comes to recording though, the plugin is only available for Chrome. And frankly, that is because of the market. When you look at what people are using, the vast, vast majority of it is Chrome. Now, tests that you create that work in IE, you can still use the recommendations, you can still use the self-healing, and that really is, as we've seen in our data, that is the primary problem that most people face. Also, if your application does work in Chrome, you can still record in Chrome and then play back in IE as well. So kind of emphasize that point. So we don't have a plan to change our plugin architecture at this point. We are standardizing on Chrome because, as I said, it does represent the vast majority of the market from that perspective. Okay, we have a whole bunch of other questions, but it's a little difficult for me to try and bring them together. So let me just, I'm going to still just quickly look through. Actually, I think I answered that one. Do you have any plans of using TestNG instead of JUnit? Yes, is the, I got a whole bunch of TestNGs. Okay, great. Yeah, so just I want to make sure that that's clear. So yes, we will be supporting both TestNG and Cucumber in the release that comes in December, focused on the self-healing and recommendation stories. Okay, so there are a couple of other questions, but I'm gonna have to actually follow up with you because one of them's a little bit detailed, and I think I need to actually probably have the R dev team kind of answer the question a little bit more specifically. I don't think I can give you a concrete answer. And that's actually regarding framework module. So we'll respond to that one offline. All right, I think that's it. Go ahead and actually bring up
a lot of questions.
It's actually
thank
great.
You guys, that was awesome.
Actually 20 questions, yeah, that's a lot. So could you actually just go to the blog for me? In fact, actually just go to the next slide in the deck. So there, if you want more information, as I said, the trial, it's available. We'd love you to get your hands on it. We also have two other channels for information. We have our YouTube. So we've been doing a lot of promotion or content generation for our YouTube channel. And then there's also our blog. So we do focus our blogs as being very technical and practical in nature. There are some kind of thought leadership pieces in there, but you'll see a lot of things around Selenium are very kind of orientated around how you can actually be helped as a practitioner. So I hope that with that being said, you guys found this all really interesting. Thank you again for the questions. This was great. Please reach out to us, email info@parasoft.com, contact the download or get access to the trial workflow, and we'd be lovely to hear from you. That being said, have a great day and look forward to seeing you on a future Parasoft webinar.
Thanks, everyone.